I would start with a general description of our business. We are a lithium producer. Allkem is a result of a merged of two companies. It is formerly Orocobre and Galaxy that have merged into Allkem about 2 years ago. And that gives us a unique global exposure to the two main sources of lithium. Orocobre came with a very large expertise and exposure in producing lithium from brines, and Galaxy came with a very large expertise and production from lithium oxide or spodumene in Western Australia. When we put together the portfolios of assets for both companies, we came together to a truly global lithium company that is growing from being just a resource company into an integrated lithium company. As you can see in the slide, our operations across South America mostly focused in brines, where we're currently producing from Olaroz Stage 1 and finalizing Olaroz Stage 2, building the Sal de Vida project. We're building the James Bay project, which is a spodumene project in Quebec, in northern Canada, basically replicating our expertise from cutting, where we are producing spodumene in Western Australia. And end of last year, we started the production, achieving first production at our Naraha plant. And Naraha plant in Japan is a plant that enables us to convert lithium carbonate, technical grade lithium carbonate, into battery grade lithium hydroxide to supply the Japanese and Korean markets mostly. In terms of how we did all this together, how we put this company together, it has been put together with a strong focus on sustainability. And we believe ourselves a leading company in terms of putting sustainability into practice. Safety being our number one priority, ensuring that our employees continue to operate and work safely, focusing on the relationship with our communities. We do operate in an area where the relationship with local communities, being this such an important subject in Australia these days, is very important. In South America, northern Argentina, we are surrounded by 10 local communities and our Olaroz operations. And our project in the James Bay region is within the Cree Nation, particularly the Cree Nation of Ismain is a community with which we work. So ensuring that this relationship with the communities is well taken care of, and understanding their needs and ensuring that we can both progress in the development of projects is quite important for us. It's also about focusing on a responsible production and targeting net zero by 2035 with two projects already started. A photovoltaic project for Sal de Vida in Argentina that is currently being built, and the James Bay project in Canada will count with a base of roughly 45% hydropower to support it. Going very quickly through our assets, as I said before, Olaroz is our first production of lithium from brines, northern Argentina in the province of Jujuy. Very good production this year already, planning to exceed last year's production, as you can see that until the end of the previous quarter, we were achieving 11,600 tons, a great cash margin. We are achieving until the third quarter of the current financial year, we're achieving a 90% cash margin in our operation from Olaroz. We already published a resource increase by 27%, growing resources to 20.7 million tons of lithium carbonate equivalent, and still a lot of potential in the area where we have only we have not yet been able to reach the basement of the basin, even though we have drilled a 1,400 deep meter well, and we continue to see potential for further brine extractions from the Olaroz Salar. The Mount Cattlin asset in Western Australia, with very good revenue today, our revenue base is roughly 50-50% between what we produce in Olaroz and what we produce in Cattlin. We started the development of the two northwest pit at the second half of last year with a bit of a rough start, and some issues that have now been completely overcome. We have had a very good first quarter of this calendar year, and remember a good quarter in this second quarter of the calendar year, fourth quarter of our financial. We will be able to meet our anticipated production in Catling. We have increased recently, and you have seen this in the market, have increased the reserves, and we have started and approved at our board the life extension of the mine by starting a new pit to access more ore from the current open pit technology as we investigate underground options. But for the time being, we have added 4 to 5 years more of life of mine to the Mancatling asset that was before approaching the end. In terms of our project execution, as said before, we have a global portfolio of projects, and it's not only the globality of this portfolio, it's also the different stages of development at which we are. We've got assets in production like Olaroz and Mt Cattlin, which we said which we are working continuously to optimize and maximize our production capacity from those two assets. Currently commissioning the Naraha plant, and we are soon starting the commissioning and will soon start first production from Olaroz stage two. We do have projects that are being constructed, like the Sal de Vida project in Catamarca, also a brine-based project in Argentina, the James Bay upstream project in Canada, in northern Quebec. This is a spodumene project. James Bay is achieving the final stages of development of approval. If you remember, in Canada, you need to have to secure two environmental social impact approvals. One comes from the federal government, which was secured back in January. The second one comes from a joint body between the Cree Nation and the Quebec government, and that is well advanced and progress, and we expect to have good news in the short term with regards to our ability to start building that project. Also, we do have a pre-feasibility studies underway for an expansion in Sal de Vida. Sal de Vida 1 will be 15,000 tons. We will be adding another 30,000 tons to Sal de Vida stage 2. We will be analyzing a dedicated purification facility and enhance project recoveries at the Olaroz asset, as well as we are currently starting further expansions on the Olaroz asset. As said before, the potential that this asset has is very large, lots of opportunities, and we think that could be further developed. In terms of other options, we are looking at North American conversion plants, replicating what we have done in the Naraha plant. We have already drilled James Bay to expand the resource, and we have published the first results of the drilling campaign. Hopefully we should be updating the reserves, and particularly the resources on James Bay shortly, as well as looking into other hydroxide facilities, not only in North America, but also in the US and potential expansions in our Japan operations. In terms of the projects are currently being built and initiating commissioning, as I said before, Olaroz stage 2 is the expansion of the first stage of Olaroz. This project will add 25,000 tons of capacity to our production from Olaroz, and we expect to initiate production from this project at the end of the current quarter with a 12 to 18 month commissioning period that should enable us to reach full production by the end of calendar year 24. In terms of the Naraha plant, as I said before, we quickly started production from Naraha, reaching a high percentage of production. We quickly reached 85% percentage of production with very good product quality. We stopped the plant to do some adjustments to the production process, and we are now in the process of starting to produce battery grade samples for our customers to qualify the product as battery grade to be able to maximize the revenue coming from this asset. In terms of our operations at Sal de Vida, as said before, this is a brine-based operation. We're already working on the construction of the first stage of Sal de Vida, where we completed the first two streams of ponds, and we're building the third stream of ponds. Sal de Vida will come in two stages, a first stage of 15,000 tons and a second stage of 30,000 tons right after completing the first stage of Sal de Vida, which should enable us to have more than 45,000 tons of production capacity from Sal de Vida plus 40,000 tons of production capacity from Olaroz, more than 85,000 tons in the short term of production coming from our assets, from our brines, from our brine-based assets. In terms of our opportunity in James Bay in Canada, as I said before, we have completed 65% of the engineering, and we have significantly progressed with some of the works on the transmission line. Hydro-Québec completed the installation of the power line to site. We have obtained federal approval, as we said. We have already placed a long lead purchase orders for all the mining equipment for James Bay, as well as the DMS plant that will be operating up there. We have completed almost 30,000 tons of resource drilling extension. We've already published some of the results of that drilling, and we're in the process of updating the resource on the back of those good drilling results. What we are seeing is a market that will continue to grow. The demand for electric vehicles is supported by the government policies, particularly in North America and the US, which are sponsoring the acquisition of new electric vehicles. It's also supported by the OEMs that have announced rolling out electric vehicle models in the next few years, but still a market that relies a lot on the Chinese side. As you can see in the chart, a lot of the demand for batteries and a lot of the battery capacity, installed battery capacity today sits in China, but we see it growing significantly in North America and the US. And we as a company are uniquely positioned to tackle this growth in North America and the US, given the location of our assets, given our ability to supply high quality product to the battery manufacturers, and also given our ESG focus, that is one of the most important things that you have to take into consideration in this market these days. Recently, and I will devote the last 3 minutes on my presentation, we have put together a merger of equals transaction, which is an all-stock merger of equals with Livent. Livent is a leading lithium company in the US. If you remember, Livent came from the FMC group of companies. FMC has been a lithium producer for more than 30 years, with more than 20 years of experience producing lithium chemicals from the province of Catamarca in South America, with a DLE technology that works very well and reliable, and with a large production capacity of hydroxide and downstream lithium assets. What we think and the key reasons underpinning this proposal for merger of equal that will be submitted to shareholder vote is basically achieving three key strategic objectives in this market. We do understand that business scale size is very important, as based on the chart that we just saw, the largest demand of lithium will be to produce electric vehicles, and as such, there would be 10 to 15 OEMs demanding most of the products. So a concentrated demand requires a very strong supply so that we can keep and maintain our bargaining power. It is also important to be able to capture the full value in the lithium supply chain. And that means that vertical integration is of the essence in this industry. We have seen a lot of volatility in the market, and we have seen the power shifting from the owners of the mines to the downstream producers or to the converters in China. And we will continue to see more of this as the market grows. The market has to grow about three times in the next 3 years, and has to more than double in the following 4 years to be able to supply all of the demand for batteries. So in order to that will bring volatility, and the power will shift. And what we want is to make sure that our shareholders have access to the full value chain of the lithium supply chain, and as such are able to maximize return and profitability from our operations. And the other thing that this merger uniquely achieves is that maintains the growth capacity from both companies, but at the same time accelerates and de-risks the growth that that we can achieve through the merged company. All of these strategic objectives have been achieved in a very volatile environment and are being supported by a best-in-class ESG practice. In terms of going very quickly through the main reasons of the merger, the two companies do have a very highly complementary business model, with Allkem more focused on the upstream assets and Livent more focused on the downstream development. But both companies do have a great presence in Argentina and Canada that enable us to have significant synergies by pulling both assets together. Significant synergies not only in operating terms, but also in CapEx terms. We will be building two mines in Canada. Livent has the Nemaska project with a downstream project in Bécancour. We have the James Bay project, James Bay and Nemaska about 100 kilometers away from each other. And the Bécancour project, the Bécancour conversion plant is a great platform for us to expand our production capacity of battery-grade lithium hydroxide into the US, adding all of the downstream capability that the asset brings. So just to finalize, and I'm still seeing Ian popping up on the screen, it is the important thing is all of this growth in terms of value and production capacity and the new merge is put together around the five core pillars that we have had in Allkem since the very beginning. We are focused in sustainability, being safety our number one priority. Growth in a market that grows aggressively, we have to ensure that we continue to have growth opportunities, de-risk the growth and maximize return for our shareholders. Focusing on our customers and producing quality product are two very important things. We understand that the value is earned in the interaction between the customers, the final buyers of the product, that will be the OEMs, and the suppliers, that are us. And one thing that is unique, all of the assets of these companies are positioned at the low quartile of the cost curve. So cost leadership in a volatile environment continues to be the number one priority on how to run your operations.
Okay, thank you, Martin. I'm only popping up because there's a number of questions coming through. And as I mentioned, some of those came through early. Give you a chance to answer some of those. Great presentation and insight to your company. You may have covered these off, but just for the sake of completeness, the first one was, when will Olaroz Stage 2 start production?
We are targeting starting production at the end of this quarter and ramping up immediately after that. It would be a ramp-up period of 18 months, roughly based on previous experiences. 12, 13 months is what I estimate.
Okay. When do you expect the James Bay project to get approval from Quebec province?
Well, the key issue is that there is no time limit on the time that the government and the Cree Nation could take to issue final approval. We understand we're at final stages of approval, given that we have already completed the public hearings and there were no major questions coming from the public hearings. All of the information have been submitted, all of the questions have been answered, and final stages of negotiation of the IBA with the Cree Nation are also happening. So for us, it's imminent. The problem is there's no time limit on the authorities that they could take to approve the project.
Okay, thank you, Martin. This one came up, I think, when you're talking about the Mount Catlin project. Are there any risks with this project?
Listen, Mount Catlin is a very good asset. We know it, we understand it, we operate it very well. We have had a production issue at the end of last year on the back of a delay in mining activity and some low quality ore. We have completed a grade control drilling that enables us to have a very good forecast of our production for the next few quarters, and the life of mine expansion that we have already put in place enables us to continue to grow from the asset. Obviously, the main risk that a spodumene project has is the volatility of the spodumene price.
Okay, and do you expect any regulatory hurdles to the announced merger? I'm guessing that's the Libet merger. And will the combined company look to divest any assets?
Well, no, the combined company would not look to divest any assets. All of the assets are good and very important for the company. And we don't expect major issues from the regulators. We've already discussed with our advisors. And, you know, antitrust presentations have been filed, and then we don't expect any drawbacks from that.
Okay, and one final one. What will be your market share in the EV market segment by 2030?
With the merged company, I estimated to be in the north of 10%, significant potential to continue growing. But we want to be a supplier of choice for all of the battery manufacturers of EVs, and that's why the scale is that important. We want everybody to have to come to us for the product, and we have to be within the value chain of the most important producers of batteries and EVs by 2030.
Great. Thank you, Martin. We are right on time. We really appreciate you joining ASX CEO Connect today and being our first presenter. So thank you, Martin, for your presentation today. We look forward to speaking with you again.
Thank you very much, Ian.
Our pleasure.
Bye now.